Heights, by the Mount Prospect State Bank, and by Ray Oldsmobile in Park Ridge.
All right, good afternoon, and welcome to Schaumburg High School in Schaumburg.
System.
Okay, I want to talk about the Forest View Falcons first. They're undefeated, 7-0 overall going into today's game.
Their last year, they're closing after this year. Fred Lesso wants to go out with a big bang, and so far he's doing it.
Schaumburg Saxons loves to throw the football. Terry, he has a guy, Paul Justin, who loves to put it up.
Yeah, he's one of the best quarterbacks in the area, and we've seen him a couple times already this year. We saw him last year, and he just loves to throw the football, and he's got great receivers in Howlett and Everett who run perfect routes for him. At least the two games that we've seen him so far this year, they run great pass routes, and Justin just delivers the ball on the time. He's a leader, and he's a great drop-back quarterback, and he's a real good prospect for the college ranks.
All right, also, the field conditions here this afternoon. All right, welcome back to Schaumburg High School. Bert Gruner along with Terry Lockman, the rest of our cable net crew. We're almost set for the opening kickoff of this afternoon's football game. But first, let's listen to the band as they play our national anthem.
What are you doing here, Pigos? Go ahead, hit me in the...
Schaumburg High School this afternoon. A big crowd here, Terry. We looked out at the stands, and it's almost standing room only as far as the bleachers go.
Biggest crowd we've had so far this year. I mean, the press box announcer was saying everybody should try to get closer together to get everybody in here. It's homecoming, and that brings back a lot of people, and the stands are just packed.
All right, Forest View and Schaumburg. The field conditions, as we talked about just for a second in the pregame, it rained all night in the Schaumburg area yesterday, and because the sun hasn't been out all day, the field soaked up a lot of water. It's very muddy out there, Terry. It's gonna affect the outcome of today's game. Of
course. Yeah, plus the fact that the sophomore game was before this one, and they tore up the field even more. So it's going to be conducive to the ground game. However, it's now raining out, so we will see the ball thrown up in the air by both teams.
Fred Lesso, the coach of Forest View, remembers last year's game where Schaumburg beat Forest View, and he says that his team didn't play very well last year. He says this year they're going to have to use the entire field, and Terry, I'd have to agree with him with this Schaumburg team. They are 4-1 in the Mid-Suburban League South Conference. Forest View at least is going to have to play a very good game in order to beat them.
Yeah, and I think this year Forest View also has more quickness and more finesse on both offense and defense, and that's one of the...
Tom Sarasani, the coach of the Schaumburg Saxons, his team, if they want to win the Mid-Suburban League South, must win today by more than 7 points.
Are we going to go through that again?
I thought I'd mention the main factor. In other words, even if they win this football game and it's a close one, it doesn't guarantee them the fact that they can win this Mid-Suburban League South.
And Conant's just sitting in the wings right now, just hoping against hope that Schaumburg only beats Forest View by 7 points, and then we have a three-way tie for first place.
We are set for the opening kickoff here at Schaumburg High School. The Forest View Falcons have won the coin toss, and they will receive the football. You get a look at the place-kicking unit of the Schaumburg Saxons. They are in red with the gold trim. Forest View, the white jerseys in the gold trim.
Here we go. Here's the kick. Let's go. Let's go.
We're set for the opening kickoff. Jack Smith, number 33, and Chris Licurio, number 24, are deep for the Forest View Falcons on a muddy football field. There's also a strong wind, which is blowing from left to right, and that'll play a factor in this football game. Kurt Farman's kick is taken by Licurio across the 20, 25 to the 30, out close to the 40-yard line. Good field position, a good start for the Forest View Falcons.
Yeah, that was a nice run back by Licurio. He did it all basically on his own because he took the ball immediately to the sidelines, and there was no blockers in front of him, and they got good field position at their own 35.
Ron Kilbasa, number 16, the quarterback of Forest View, will call the signals this afternoon. It's first and 10 for Forest View from the 40-yard line. They will be changing the football a lot this afternoon. Dan Bazaar and Brad Quast, the two backs. That's Quast in motion. Kilbasa on an option to Bazaar, turns the corner right side. Gets out to the 47. First offensive play is a good one for Forest View.
Well, that'll help string out the Schaumburg defense also to start by going on the outside like that. Bazaar's got good speed going to the outside. And we've seen that option play done the last couple of times we saw Forest View, and it's worked real well for him because Kilbasa will keep it too, and he's a good runner.
Ron Kilbasa, 31 of 56 for 648 yards coming into today's game. He's thrown for 8 touchdowns. Same backfield again, I formation, Quast and Bazaar. This is Quast, off tackle, right side. Maybe a couple. Brought down by number 66, Eric Thorson. Close to midfield, very close to a first down.
That was good defense by Schaumburg and Thorson on that play to stop Quast because he's a big kid. They gave him the ball in those short yardage situations to try to have him barrel through there, and that time he got stopped. It's a big play, third and two.
Just inside the 50 is the football. Quick pitch, Bazaar turns the corner, left side across the 50. He's got a first down. Gang tackled in Saxon territory and knocked out of bounds at the 43-yard line.
We got a flag on the play there, too, and that might be an illegal use of hands on a block or a holding call. It was in that general area. And it looks like it's going against Forest View, and that's what it was, illegal use of hands.
You're right. Mike Howlett and Mike Everett were the Saxon defenders that knocked them out of bounds, but they're going to have to bring it back, and they'll do it over again.
Yeah, that'll take away a first down for Forest View also, and they were moving the ball real well on the ground those first three plays. It's just a great crowd here today. This is the biggest crowd I've seen in a high school football game in a long time, and the Schaumburg fans know the importance of this football game for Schaumburg's hopes of winning the MSL South.
First penalty of the ball game goes against Forest View. It'll cost them 5. 10:02 to go in the first quarter. No score between Schaumburg and Forest View. It is a 3rd and 6 situation. Let's see if Kilbasa puts it up. Rollout, Kilbasa, under heavy pressure, across midfield, very close to a first down, brought down by Steve Bosler, 5'11", 175-pound defensive back, who brought him down just shy of the first down marker. He'll be about a yard short.
Yeah, that was a good run by Kilbasa. I thought he was going to get it. And there you see Ron Kilbasa, 5'9", 165-pound junior quarterback at Forest View, doing a great job for the Falcons so far this year.
Fred Lussell will take no chances, and so Jeff Prince will punt it away. Into the wind, a fair catch signaled for by Steve Bosler at the 27, and so the Schaumburg Saxons will start first and 10.
Well, that was a real high snap, and Prince did a good job getting that ball back and got off a fairly good kick against the wind. Ball's going to be tough to catch today, only because of all the mud on the field, and that wind is real difficult to judge when you're trying to catch punts.
You are about to see probably the passing attack known as Air Sirisani. Tom Sirisani, the head coach of the Schaumburg Saxons. Paul Justin, one of the league's best passers. He's a great dropback quarterback, great arm, 62 of 155 coming into this afternoon's game. He's thrown for over 1,000 yards. He's tossed 10 touchdowns. This guy can operate. And with the wind, you'll probably be seeing Schaumburg put the football up in the air. Justin, and on the first play, the handoff went to Nick Panzik, the running back.
And there was Brad Klass. We talked about him in pregame, how he barrels through offensive lines to sack running backs in the backfield, and he just proved our point there. He's a big kid, tough to stop. He's one of those kids that's hungry and always wants to get at the ball.
And not only that, Terry, he probably has the most deceptive speed out of anybody on the football field. You get a look at him, 6'2", 230, but he is as quick as any player out on the football field. A loss of 7 on the play, 2nd and 17. Justin on play action, slips. He's got the football, he's got a man open. Mike Howlett out near the 45.
Well, the last time we saw Schaumburg play, Howlett had one of the biggest games of his high school career. And on the first passing play by Schaumburg today, Howlett again shows how great pass routes he runs. And that was just a perfect strike by Justin. First down.
They spot it at the 45, and it is a Saxon first down. Handoff up the middle.
Well, you can see what Coach Sarazani is doing right here, at least at the outset of the football game. He's throwing a balanced attack at Forest View, and I bet you Forest View thought they were going to come in and start passing the ball, and so far it's been two runs and a pass. And you know that if they establish a running game, Justin's going to have just a heck of a ball game through the air.
That last play was a pickup of 6 for John Singstock. You get the numbers on Paul Justin. 2nd down 4, good situation to be in. Handoff this time. Panzik. Back to the original line of scrimmage. Brian McCarthy in on the stop.
And the last couple times we've seen Forest View, Brian McCarthy and Brad Quast have both done an excellent job on defense and stopping the run. It's amazing after 7 games to see that Paul Justin has thrown for over 1,000 yards as a high school quarterback. Those are just amazing numbers, and he's still got 2 more games to go to add to that total.
They spot it at the 49. They say a loss of about 2, so it's 3rd and 6, a definite passing situation. Jeff Duden in motion, number 31. Justin wants the throw, dumps it off. He's got a man open. Howlett into Falcon territory.
Another big play by Schaumburg. Excellent throw by Justin under pressure. The blitz was on by Forest View, and Howlett was just wide open. Forest View defensive backs are giving Howlett a lot of room because they know the danger of him going long.
David Eddy and Steve Polis in on the stop for the Falcons. That is a first down.
There you see Paul Justin, the quarterback for Schaumburg. Got good size, good prospect for college. 6'3", close to 200 pounds.
6:10 to go, first quarter. No score, Schaumburg and Forest View. Fumble on the play. The handoff was to John Sengstock. He fumbled it, but he fell on his own fumble. That'll go as no gain, and a big recovery by Sengstock. Wasn't a flagrant fumble, as if the ball skidded away from him, but he was fortunate enough to fall on top of it.
Heads up play by Sengstock. Schaumburg is controlling this ball. They've had the ball for almost the entire first quarter, except for 4 plays by Forest View.
2nd and 9, Everett, number 89, lines up as a tight end. This is Jeff Duden in motion. Justin, rollout, left side, wants the throw. Everybody's covered. He's got a man open, number 89, Everett, across field, out of bounds at the 24-yard line. Great throw.
Great throw again by Justin. He's 3 for 3, and those are the 2 receivers we talked about at the beginning of the game. Everett and Howlett, they've both done an outstanding job so far this year, and Justin loves to throw to both of them. And they've both got outstanding hands. If the ball's anywhere near them, they're going to come up with it.
Another first down for the Schaumburg Saxons. 1st and 10 at the Forest View Falcon 24. 5:28 left to go in the first quarter, no score. This is Duden lining up wide to the right. Draw play. Panzik. He'll be nailed for a loss.
He was stopped by number 77, Louis Condorose.
Kevin Quass was in on the play, too, the brother of Brad Quass. Loss of six.
Now, this is a big defensive series right now for Forest View. If they can hold down Schaumburg here without a score, because Schaumburg's just moved right down the field.
Howlett is wide to the left. Number 31, Duden, goes in motion. The up back is Sengstock. Justin has a lot of time rolling out right side. Penalty flags are down. Intended for number 89, Mike Howlett. A terrific defensive play by number 17, Steve Polis, to knock it out of bounds, but there is a flag down.
That's in the general area of holding, too. I would imagine that would move Schaumburg back some more yardage. We're going to see the replay on that again. See, the rush was on, and Justin does a good job in rolling out to the outside. And a great defensive play by number 17, Steve Poulos, knocked the ball away from Everett. And Schaumburg is moving back, so it looks like it's a holding call on Schaumburg. So after the six-yard loss and now a penalty, this drive that was very promising at the outset is starting to move back.
This will cost the Saxons 10 yards. Now, Terry, last week, Schaumburg lost to Conant by a score of 13-6 in a game that was played in the rain. Definitely hurts a passing team, but so far, if you throw out this penalty, they've been able to move the football.
Well, yeah, Justin's 3-for-3, and it's not raining out. The only problem is footing.
Second down, 26 for Schaumburg. Justin, straight, quick drop, going deep. In and out of the hands of number 12, Mike Howlett, who almost came up with a great catch. That was a beautiful throw by Justin.
Well, that throw was right on the money. You couldn't put the ball in any better place than where it was at. Howlett was covered by two defensive backs for Forest View, and the ball just went off his fingertips. He almost came up with an outstanding catch. And I think he would like to have that one back.
David Eddy, number 7, was the defensive back responsible on the coverage. A lot of pressure this afternoon on the secondary of the Forest View Falcons with this Air Sirasani attack. Now it's 3rd and 26. Sengstock in the backfield. And now Justin, rolling out right side under heavy pressure, unloads the football. Almost picked off. Chris Licario.
I think that's one pass that Paul Justin should not have thrown. He was under a lot of pressure, and he didn't really have good footing, and he just tried to heave the ball up, and that's what happened. He threw pretty much of a dying football that could have been easily picked off.
A dangerous throw, fortunately for Schaumburg. Pass was incomplete. On fourth down, let's see what Tom Sirasani does. They're at the 40, and he's going to kick the football away. Dan Neenan, number 25, will punt it away. This kick will come from about midfield.
Well, they're going to try to pin Forest View deep in their own territory. We're going to see him aim for the corner.
Jack Smith is deep to return it for Forest View. This is a good kick with the wind. Smith takes it and slips at about the 12-yard line. You get a look at the field condition. Smith had to step up to catch the football, and he would have had some field room, but he slipped and fell.
Well, as we said at the beginning of the game, you know, Schaumburg moved the football down real well on that opening drive, except the penalties hurt him and that sack hurt him. But if you look at the field, the footing is really bad, and it's going to be in favor of Schaumburg, because Everett and Howlett know where their pass routes are, and they know where they're going.
On first down, Kilbasa hands the ball up to Dan Bazaar. Breaks two, tackles. Gets across the 20-yard line before he's brought down by Matt Sepsi. Bazaar showing us his quickness.
Another great run by Bazaar. The thing that was so great about that play right there was the hole that was opened up by the offensive line of Forest View. A truck could have gone through that hole that Bazaar went through.
Number 12, Howlett, the strong safety for Schaumburg, about 12 yards off the line of scrimmage, and Kilbasa on a 1st and 10, hands it again to Bazaar, goes right tackle, another good gain by Dan Bazaar. He was finally brought down by Mike Pajak, number 40.
Well, Wheeling's run two. There you see Ron Kilduss' numbers for the year, 31 out of 56 for 648 yards and 8 touchdown passes. So he does throw the ball up in the air, and he's got a strong arm.
Second and six. Roa Kilbasa. They string it out. He may have gotten back to the original line of scrimmage if he's lucky. He was finally ridden out of bounds by Scott Jones, number 52.
Well, I was just going to mention that before we went to Ron Kilbasa's numbers, but the first two plays ahead of this drive, they went right up the middle, and I wouldn't have been surprised to see Kilbasa go around on the outside, because in the two games that we've seen Forest View previous to this, they do a lot of rolling out. And what Kilbasa will do on that now is he'll roll out, fake the run, and throw the ball downfield.
We got an official's timeout right now. There's 2:26 left to go in the first quarter. There's no score between the Schaumburg Saxons and the Forest View Falcons. We're here at Schaumburg High School. It's their homecoming this afternoon. A big crowd on hand for today's football game.
Numbers on Dan Bazaar for Forest View, 5 rushes, 28 yards.
On third and five, Steve Polis is wide to the right side. Dave Eddy split to the left side. There's a handoff this time up the middle to Smith.
Well, Schaumburg's keying on the run, and that was a third down. 2 yards, 3 yards to go, and you know, you gotta see him throw the ball up in the air. You gotta open up that Schaumburg defense, and they haven't done that so far, so all Schaumburg is doing is just keying on the run. But I'm sure before this game is over, if we're going to see Kilbasa put up the ball a few times, because he does have that good strong arm, and Lussau's got the confidence in him.
This brings up a fourth down situation, fourth and two, and the punter Jeff Prince is on. Short kick off the side of his foot, and the ball just stops about the 42-yard line, where the Saxons will have excellent field position. Carry a rough break for 40.
Yeah, that was it hit right off the side of his foot, and that punt only netted about 10 yards. That's going to be a big break for Schaumburg, and it's up to the Wheeling defense now to shut down Schaumburg.
They spotted at the 42. It'll be first and 10 for Schaumburg. Howlett will go wide to the right side this time. Everett is the tight end. He'll line up on the strong side of the field. Bazaar and Panzik, the two backs. Make that Sengstock. This is Panzik. Turns the corner right side, gets out to about the 38.
Well, while we got a quick break here, Brett, I'd like to mention this game is being brought to you in part by Flaherty Jewelers, your personal jeweler for fine diamond jewelry and jewelry repairs at 2 South Dutton in downtown Arlington Heights. By the Mount Prospect State Bank for all your financial needs at the corner of Bussey and Emerson in downtown Mount Prospect. And by Ray Oldsmobile, 501 Bussey Highway in Park Ridge, where our customers send their friends.
Second and six for the Schaumburg Saxons. Duden in motion from the 38-yard line of Forest View. Sengstock, big gainer. Out near the 20, a powerful run by John Sengstock, finally brought down by Dave Eddy.
Excellent power run by Sengstock. Excellent job by the Schaumburg offensive line to open up that hole. And did you see the ball movement by Justin? They say he's a great passing quarterback, but he held that ball real nicely and faked the one back coming through, and then we're going to see it again. He faked the one back going through first, and then he handed off to Sengstock, who just powered his way for a gain of about 12 to 14 yards. Good play by Schaumburg. They're on a roll.
First and 10 from the 20. Again, Sengstock off tackle right side. A gain of about two, finally brought down by Kurt Farman. Check that, Thomas O'Malley on the stop. And that is the end of the first quarter of play here at Schaumburg High School in Schaumburg. With the score, Schaumburg nothing, Forest View nothing. You're watching high school football on cable net. We'll be back. This is Nick Panzik. Back to the original line of scrimmage. I don't know if our viewers had a chance to catch that last play. Nick Panzik on the carry, the handoff from Justin. He got probably back to the original line of scrimmage. It'll be third down and 8 for the Schaumburg Saxons. Woolard, the center, number 50. get a look at his jersey and you'll see what the field conditions are like. On third and eight, let's see what Justin and the Schaumburg Saxons do. Quick drop. Had to unload the football. And they rule an interception by number 44. Scott Miller, Terry, from here, it looked like it was a definite trap.
It looked like it was too, but the official was right there. He had a better angle on it than us. But it looked like he picked it off the ground. We're going to take a look at it again. Let's see if we can tell on the replay if he did catch that ball or if he trapped it.
You'll see the pressure.
Well, that was a tough angle there too, but the referee was standing right there, so obviously he saw it correctly and made the right call. Big defensive play by Forest View.
First and 10 from the 5, Kielbasa. Big turnover. Hand off to Quast.
Well, the Schaumburg defense is fired up. They're stopping everything on the run, and Forest View has got to recognize that and try to put the ball up in the air, even though they are deep in their own territory. They've got to move it out and get at least a first down, because it's going to be tough to punt that far in your own territory.
A big, big turnover. I don't really think that was an interception here. I do believe he did trap the football, but as a result, that cost Schaumburg a shot at least three. On second down, Quas goes in motion. Quick pitch, bizarre. Left side, a lot of running room. Out near the 18-yard line.
Well, that was all bizarre. He did a great job to get the first down for Forest View.
Dave Gierke, number 64, in on the stop for the Saxons. That is a Forest View Falcon first down.
There you see Daily Herald sports writer Keith Reinhardt. I think he follows us to every game we do.
I think he does, too. First and 10 from the 17. Forest View with the football on the move as a result of the turnover. Bizarre again. A lot of running room. Good play that time. He was finally tripped up by Dan Neenan, number 25, but this is another first down out close to the 30-yard line. A good run by Bizarre.
Well, Bizarre is just showing his running ability so far. He's close to 50 yards already rushing on 7 attempts. And I said they had to throw the ball to get out of there. Well, they're doing a good job running with Bizarre back there.
Dennis Kirchovic is the center for Forest View. Another first down. They spot it at the 28. This is Eddie. Eddie will be nailed for a loss.
Matt Sepsi on the stop. That was a great stop by Sepsi. Eddie's a big kid, and he had some running room, but Sepsi made a good read on the play, came in there and stopped Eddie behind the line of scrimmage. We're going to see it again. And Sepsi just finds his way through there and gives Eddie a good shot. Big defensive play by Sepsi and Schaumburg.
They say no gain. It'll be second and 10, 8:40 to go in the second quarter. No score between Forest View and Schaumburg. This is Bizarre. A lot of running room out to the 30. Gets close to midfield before he's gang tackled.
Well, Bizarre
brought down by Dan Neenan.
Again, Bizarre showed some great moves getting out in front of the line of scrimmage there. Once getting around the line of scrimmage, showed some quick feet and stepped to his left and got into the open field over the middle and almost broke it for a touchdown. He just slipped up a little bit before he got to make his move on the Schaumburg defender, Neenan.
Neenan and Matt Sepsi in on the play. They spotted at the 50. It's another first down for Forest View. Eddie lines up wide as a slot back. This time Polis as the receiver. Quick pitch to Bizarre. Maybe a gain of 6. Again, Matt Sepsi in on the stop for Schaumburg.
Again, Fred Lessau's game plan so far is just keep this football on the ground and try to run it right up Schaumburg's gut, and that so far has worked on this offensive series, and Bizarre is just having a great day here in the first half.
Eddie is the flanker, the right side of the field. Polis lines up wide to the left. Looks like Quast.
Well, Schaumburg was expecting that. They're 5 yards away. They handed it to Quast, their big guy. He got about two on the play. It's going to bring up a third and three. It'll be an interesting call here now for Forest View because they have not thrown a pass yet. The total on Bazaar so far, nine rushes for 78 yards in the first half.
7 minutes to go in the second quarter. No score between Forest View and Schaumburg, but the Falcons are on the move. Second and four from the 44. That's Smith in motion. This is a pitch this time to Bazaar. A lot of traffic. Probably no gain.
Stop by number 89, Mike Everett. Well, this will be an interesting call now for Forest View. But I think I see the punting unit come out.
They've Everett got the, read it beautifully.
Yeah, Everett sure did. He read that play beautifully to stop him short of the first down.
This brings up a fourth down situation. The Forest View Falcons will punt it away as number 11, Jeff Prince, comes in to kick. Short snap, Quast. Looks like he's short of a first down.
Well, that was a fake. They faked on that play right there. Schaumburg takes over. Great play by Schaumburg. We're going to come right back. I take that back. We're already back. That was one of the quickest commercials I've seen yet so far on CableNet. Schaumburg takes over. Great defensive play. They didn't bite at all on that fake.
They did try a fake. Fred Lusso thought he might be able to pick up at least four on that play. Tough call with the footing as bad as it is out there. So the Saxons with good field position have to go into the wind. First and 10 from their own 42. This is Sengstock.
Flags all over the place on that play. Looks like illegal motion against Schaumburg. I didn't see who moved, but that's usually the general call when both flags go up on either side of the field. And that's what
that's
it was.
That's what it is. Scott Miller was in on the stop for Forest View, but they'll have to do it all over again.
I don't know. They lost a yard on that play. They might decline this penalty.
And they do. So it's second and 10. They say no gain. You get a look at the Saxon huddle. Howlett will go wide to the left. Jeff Duden, number 31, will line up as a slot back. And Sengstock is the only running back this time. Paul Justin, the quarterback, see what he does. On a slot back reverse, they handed it to Jeff Duden, but the defensive Forest View read it perfectly.
Boy, Paul Justin took a big hit by Brad Quast after he handed the ball off. That's what got the Schaumburg fans a little bit excited over here. No gain. Good play by the Forest View defense. You know, this is a perfect time for Justin to put the ball up in the air, but it's also a great time to throw in a draw play.
Third and 11. Everett, the tight end, lines up on the left side this time. I formation. Duden lines up as a slot. And Howlett is the flanker out to the right side of the field. Justin wants to throw. Threw it over the middle, intended for Mike Everett, but he overlet him. Good coverage that time by the secondary. Scott Miller, the defensive back, along with number 17, Steve Polis. Good defensive play by Forest View. That'll mean on fourth down, Schaumburg will have to kick it away.
Yeah, Forest View came in with a partial blitz on that play to put a little pressure on Justin, and that threw him off just a little bit, and there was good coverage downfield by the defensive backs of Forest View.
Dan Neenan, the punter, is in to do the kicking for Schaumburg. Jack Smith is the deep man for Forest View. His kick will come from around the 30-yard line into the wind. A little bit of a high snap. Short kick. Ball lands at the 50, and
Schaumburg
downs it at the 49.
Excellent field position for Forest View. We're going to come right back after this short break.
No score, 4 minutes to go, and on first down.
It's not special finance rates or special safe.
Pickup of maybe three.
We got about second down and eight to go now. 3:35 left in the first half.
Who is this time goes to the left side. David Eddy is wide to the right. Smith and Bazaar, the two backs. Play action. Kilbasa will put it up maybe. His receivers are all covered. He finally unloads it. It was intended for David Eddy. He wants a pass interference call, but good coverage by Mike Howlett. Pass will go incomplete.
Good coverage by Mike Howlett. I was watching as Eddy was coming out, and both receivers, Eddy and number 81, Thomas O'Malley, they were in a crossing pattern, and they got confused with each other. They almost ran right into each other, and that's what Kilbasa did a great job in hiding the football when he came back. However, in the little mix-up that Eddy and O'Malley had, that's what threw the timing off of that play.
Third and eight, a four-man defensive front for the Saxons. Kilbasa will throw again. Straight drop, heavy pressure. Finally unloads it, incomplete, intended for number 81, Thomas O'Malley. Good defensive pressure was put on by...
That was number 65, J.C. Farb, who finally got to Kilbasa Forest View and gave him a pretty good shot there from behind. Kilbasa didn't see it coming, and that's what threw that pass off, too. So it started as promising field position for Forest View. The Schaumburg defense did a great job in stopping them and forcing them to punt again.
With the win, Jeff Prince is in to do the punting. Bosler and Howlett are deep. Knuckleball. Bosler will pick it up. Across the 20, out to the 25, near the 30-yard line. That's where he's knocked out of bounds. And that's where the Schaumburg Saxons will start first and 10. So with no score in the first half, you're watching high school football on CableNet. We'll be right back. Bert Grunner and Terry Lockman back at Schaumburg High School. While we were away, Schaumburg lined up in a shotgun formation on first down, and Paul Justin's pass was picked off by Steve Polis.
So again, another big play by Forest View that gives them excellent field position. Ball on Schaumburg's 34-yard line. 2.5 minutes left here in the first half. Be a big boost for them to get on the board with any kind of points here after that turnover.
Second big turnover of the football game by Schaumburg, and from the 34, as Terry said, this is Kilbasa on first and 10. See what he does with the football. He wants to throw on first down. Heavy pursuit this time. Goes downfield, overthrown, number 7, David Eddy. Good coverage by Mike Howlett.
Good coverage by Howlett on that play. And again, good pressure shown by the Schaumburg defensive unit here. Putting that pressure on Kilbasa. I wouldn't be surprised now to see Kilbasa try something on the rollout that they've had so much success throughout the year on.
Second and 10 again from the 34. The Falcons have the wind at their back, and it is a brisk wind, about 15 miles an hour from the east, or I should say from the west. Sprint out, Kilbasa. He has a man open, Polis. Out near about the 6-yard line.
And as we said earlier in the pregame, Kilbasa's got the strong arm, and Polis just ran a very good pass pattern, and Kilbasa spotted him across the middle. We're seeing it again now. Kilbasa had the time back there. Good protection this time. Got to set up, and he found Polis over the middle. Shot stopped just short of the 5-yard line. So here we have our first scoring opportunity for Forest View in the ball game.
All this coming as a result of the intercepted pass by Polis. So he's come up with two basically big plays in a row for the Forest View Falcons. First and goal now just inside the 6-yard line. And Forest View wants a timeout. And with no score late in the second quarter, we'll take a commercial break. We'll be right back. Terry Lockman back at Schaumburg High School.
Well, that's real.
Falcons using...
That was a smart timeout by Fred Lussau. The clock was running down, and The kids were excited they were down that close. This is the first time we've had anybody in real good scoring position inside the 10-yard line on either side. And the kids were excited, and that was a good timeout. Settle them down and get a good play.
First and goal. Let's see what Fred Lusso decides to do. Quas is the fullback, Bizarre the tailback. Tight defensive alignment for Schaumburg. Quick pitch, Bizarre, nailed for a loss.
Well, that was read beautifully by Hollett. They expected that, took the timeout. Lusso wanted to go to what has been working for them all season, the option rollout by Kielbasa. And Hollett did not bite at all on that play. He was right there.
A loss of four. Second and goal from the nine. Polis and Eddie are wide to the right side of the field. Rollout, Kielbasa, he's going to keep it. Game tackle just at about the 7-yard line.
Well, that timeout also fired up the Schaumburg defense to stop for a few. They've got to try to pass the ball, I would imagine, somewhere over the middle, try to open something up. Quick drop and a pass over the middle to Eddie, who's been a real good receiver for Kielbasa all year.
This will be third and goal from about the six. Bizarre. About 2 or 3 yards. Dave Gerke was in on the stop for Schaumburg. This will bring up a fourth down situation. Forestview again with a timeout.
Schaumburg did a great job there. They're going to come in with a field goal unit, try to get 3 points out of this play. But first and goal from the 6-yard line, and I think they gained 2 yards on three plays. So it was just an outstanding job by the Schaumburg defense. Got to give them credit. Got to give credit to Coach Tom Sarazani for firing them up there during that timeout that Forestview had taken. And you know, if they can come
back to live action here, Fred Lusso is going to attempt a field goal here. On fourth down, here, I think he wants to play it safe, being this deep in Schaumburg territory. There are no chip shots because of the field conditions, but I think this is his best chance of getting something on the board before the half. 15 seconds to go. Here's Prince's kick. No signal yet. It is good. So with 10 seconds left to go in the second quarter, the Forest View Falcons jump on top on a field goal by Jeff Prince, and they lead it by the score of 3-0.
I tell you what that really did there, though. Schaumburg was real good on the goal line stand that they had there, and had Forest View missed that one, you know, all the momentum would have been going Schaumburg's way. However, the momentum is still with Schaumburg, I believe, by just holding them to 3 points.
There's 10 seconds left in the half. We'll see the kickoff, and if we're lucky, maybe one more play after that. I would expect that Forest View would not kick this football deep so that Schaumburg can set up a return. I think they're going to want to squib it and probably get it somewhere in the middle of the pack so that Schaumburg can't set up a return.
Now they've got Howlett back there, who's one of the quicker guys on the team. And also number 8, Ray Dybel.
John Cole to do the kicking. There's 10 seconds left to go in the second quarter. And his kick is not a long one. Taken at the 20-yard line by Steve Van Ness. Gets out near the 30. Scott Miller in on the tackle. That used up 6 seconds, so this will very likely be the last play of the first half.
That play, or that kick by John Cole, see, he had the wind at his back, so he just tried to boom it. And what happened was he tried to boom it so hard that he slipped a little bit before he kicked the ball, and that's why Van Ness had a chance to run that one back. And that's the end of the first half in a defensive struggle here between Schaumburg and Forest View to see who's going to be the champion of the... We have a little bit of controversy up here in the booth talking about that. Was that interception or was that a trap by Miller of Forest View?
Well, that happened late in the first quarter, and I'd be willing to bet my car, Terry, that that he did trap that point. I think the official didn't have an angle on it, and from here, and I had the binoculars on Scott Miller when he did try and intercept the football. It was close, but I know that was a trap. You say it was an interception.
Yeah, I know it was an interception. You say it was a trap. So, you know, I've got the official on my side and probably all of the Schaumburg fans against me, so it's a no-win situation as far as I'm concerned. But it was surprisingly, it was a defensive battle in the first half. I thought for sure we were going to see a lot of points on the board with both offenses that we've seen so far this year. But it was a defensive struggle.
It was, and of course, the defense really is what enabled Forest View to be up 3-0 at this point. The interception by Miller, and of course the interception by Polis while we had a commercial break, but that set up at least the field goal by Prince, and then put Forest View up by the score 3-0. And you know, I mean, Schaumburg has played well in the first half, especially the defensive stand late in the second quarter when Forest View did have a chance to get up.
And that might be a key. I'm sure Tom Sarazani has got his troops in there in halftime, giving them the talk that how well their defense did in stopping Forest View, their first and goal on the 6-yard line. And I'm sure that'll be a key for them. But as we take a look at the Schaumburg pom-pom girls, we're also going to listen to the Schaumburg band here for homecoming festivities. So why don't we sit back and take a look at the halftime festivities here at Schaumburg. There is the homecoming king, Tony Eboli, I believe you pronounce his last name. If I mispronounce that, please excuse me.
Good day to get dressed up and walk in the mud, isn't it?
Well, that's the homecoming queen right there, and she's also one of the pom-pom girls who got a little dirty out there during the opening of halftime festivities. So we're getting a nice, clean, wholesome look at the king and queen, and she's getting a kick out of it, too. That's Michelle Carfanini. And the rest of the Schaumburg court. And the name for this homecoming festivities is We Are the World, and that's what song they're going to play right now. Okay, there you get a look at the Schaumburg Saxons. It'd be interesting to see what Coach Tom Sarazani had to say to his troops there at halftime, only down 3-0 in this very important title game for the MSL South Crown.
I think, first of all, he probably told Paul Justin, as far as those passes were concerned, not to unload the football under those circumstances, because it did really cost them a lot of field position and an opportunity at some points. I think they're only down 3-0, and I mean, it's still a very big football game. I don't think that either team should change the style or the attitude, in other words, the way they went into the game. I don't think they should change that. I think also, Terry, we talked about this before, that a touchdown really for either team would look very big, because it seems that both teams are having a lot of difficulty.
You know, that might also have had an effect of this game being so big that, you know, both teams might have been a little tight had they gotten down that close, as Forest View did, as Schaumburg did there in the first half, that maybe they got just a little bit tight and a little bit tense to try to put that ball into the end zone. I think we might see a couple of different teams coming out here. I think another thing that Tom Cerezzani might have said to Paul Justin is that he doesn't have to rush his throws. You know, he's getting some pressure, but a lot of those throws that he, especially the two interceptions, especially the first interception, which was that controversial one we were talking about, he rushed his throw on that one, and he tried to unload it in a hurry, and that's what cost him the interception. So maybe you told him just not rush his passes and wait for the receivers to run their routes and try to hit him.
Right, I also think the defensive positioning of Brad Quast has a lot to do with the safety, the strong and the weak safety, in order to open up the flat areas and the middle zone of the field. And I think that he's going to have to start going long. You see the numbers on Justin, 3 of 8, 52 yards, 2 interceptions. I think he's going to have to start going a little bit deeper in order to open up the middle part of the field.
Yeah, there's no doubt about that. And on the other side of the field with Forest View, they showed some great running by Bizarre. They opened up some big holes for him, and he showed some individual running skills that enabled him to get to 76.
Well, we are about set for the opening kickoff here of the second half of play. It is 3-0 in favor of the Forest View Falcons here at Schaumburg High School. Forest View will kick the football off. Number 20, John Cole, will tee it up. John Sengstock is the deep man. He'll be flanked by Ray Dybel. Steve Van Ness back there for Schaumburg, along with Matt Sepsi. So we're about set to go for football here on CableNet. 3-0 Forest View.
Again, we've mentioned this. You know, it's going to be a very important set of downs for both teams, offensively and defensively. Offensively for Schaumburg and defensively for Forest View, to try to hold these, you know, both teams down. And if Schaumburg can get on a roll here by passing the ball here on this first series, because
opening kickoff of the second half by Cole. This is Matt Sepsi. Has a lot of running room. Across the 40-yard line, knocked out of bounds at about the 44.
Excellent.
Good start for Schaumburg.
Excellent return by Sepsi. Gets him out to the 44-yard line. Great field position. And we've talked about that momentum factor. And it's on that kind of a kickoff return, it definitely swings in favor of Schaumburg. And I wouldn't be surprised to see Ball Justin come out firing the football and maybe even go deep on their first play.
From their own 44-yard line, it's first and 10, Schaumburg in red on a muddy field here at Schaumburg High School. Howlett and Duden are the two receivers on first down. Fumble. It appears that Forest View recovered the football.
Yep, they did. That's Forest View's football. Another big turnover for Forest View. That's the third one today. I didn't see if it was just a bad handoff or they never just got control of the football.
Well, they tried a counter play that time, which is not the easiest play in the world to execute. I think the handoff was supposed to go to Nick Panzik, and I think there was obviously a mix-up between Justin and Panzik. So on the turnover, another big one. First and 10, Forest View from the 40, about the 42-yard line of Schaumburg. Ron Kilbasa, straight drop, puts it up. He's got Eddie open, complete. Out of bounds at the 11-yard line.
Well, that was just a great pass and a great play by Eddie to get open. He ran a great route. Kilbasa delivered the ball right on the money. And there was two defenders there. Howlett was one of them.
Scott Jones, too.
And number 52, Scott. And we're going to see it again. And just look at how perfect this pass was. Eddie just right on the numbers. First and goal from the 10-yard line now for Forest View. Talk about coming back after a turnover and getting a team when they're down. That's exactly what Fred Lussow and his Forest View troops did.
Terry Minchin, first and goal. Just inside the 10, Bazaar. Hammered. Dennis Stoika, number 51, and on the tackle.
Well, they tried, you know, on that play right there, I would have, on first down, I would have tried to pass because Schaumburg was just definitely waiting for the run. I would have tried to pass somewhere over the middle to try to, you know, open things up for the run down deep. Because if you recall, late in the first half, Schaumburg's defense did a great job in stopping Forest View in this same situation.
Kevin Quash checks into the ballgame. He'll line up as a tight end. They say no gain, second and 10 for Forest View. Bazaar stopped at the line of scrimmage. Looked like Bazaar slipped that time.
We're gonna see it again, and I don't think he really slipped. He was just met right at the line of scrimmage by number 65, J.C. Favre. Great defensive play, third down, and still 10 yards to go. Schaumburg's done an excellent job holding him.
Eddie and Polis are the receivers this time to the left side of the field. Kilbasa goes end zone. Touchdown, Eddie.
Well, I don't know why they didn't try that on first or second down. Eddie was wide open. They had three receivers back there. Eddie, number 21. Dan Bazaar was back there. And also O'Malley.
David Eddie and Steve Polis got underneath the two safety men in the end zone. And really, either one of them could have caught the football. David Eddie with a good route that time. It is now 9-0 Forest View.
Here's the replay. Wide open was Eddie. 6 points, and that's a big 6 points for Forest View.
Kilbasa will hold the extra point attempt by Prince. Is no good.
Well, that helps Schaumburg, but Forest View capitalizes on the fumble. And we'll be right back with a score 9-0 in favor of Forest View. And St. Vider taking on Joliet Catholic next week in our final regular season ball game. Should be a big one.
That will definitely be a good game. We're trying to zero in on who the injured player is. Forest View by a score of 10-0. Dave Floyd is now in at one of the running back positions for Schaumburg, seeing his first action of the game. Sengstock, a mix-up that time. He'll be nailed for a loss. Kevin Quaston on the play.
There we show Quaston getting in on there, and that play just didn't develop very well at all for Schaumburg. There was a mix-up in the backfield as to who to hand off to, and it's, again, it might be the complexity of the running attack by Coach Sarazani, because there was just too many cuts and fake handouts in the backfield there. And Quast just read it and plugged up the whole play. There you see Brad Quast.
Second down, 14 for Paul Justin. Quick drop. Going left sideline. Good try. Almost completed a pass to Mike Howlett. The timing was there, I think. Howlett had to look over the other shoulder, Terry. He would have brought that ball down.
Yeah, what happened when it was with Howlett is that he was expecting it to come one way, and he had to turn around. The ball turned around, and it's real difficult to make a catch when you have to turn around like that and try to pick the ball back up, and he almost pulled it off. With the success that Schaumburg had on their opening series with Justin throwing to Howlett and to Everett, ever since then they really haven't been able to move the ball through the air.
Third and 14, another passing situation for Paul Justin. Straight drop, has a man open. Complete to Mike Howlett. Scott Miller on the coverage, and that is a first down for Schaumburg.
Well, as soon as I said that, who they go to, Mike Howlett, who shows the good hands. Again, ran a good pattern, got right over the first down marker, and it was a perfect pass by Justin. No way that ball could have been intercepted. Threw it down low, and the only person who could have caught it was the person who did, and that was Mike Howlett. First down for Schaumburg.
They spotted at the 36. That sort of gets the crowd back into the football game. They were in a little bit of a lull with their team trailing 9-0. From the 36, first and 10 for the Schaumburg Saxons. Sengstock and Nick Tanzik, the two backs. And this time the handoff goes to Everett, Mike Everett, on an end around.
Again, that shows the quickness of the 4SU defense. That was a nice hole that was opened up by the offensive line on the end around by Everett. Gained about 5 yards, but if it wasn't for the quickness of 4SU, that play would have gone for a lot more yardage.
A pickup of 6, call it 2nd and 4. 7:55 to go in the third quarter. It's Forest View 9 and Schaumburg nothing. Jeff Duden in the slot to the right side. Quick pass over the middle, in and out of Everett's hands.
Good coverage by Poulos there. His ball almost ended up in his hands. And had Everett caught that ball, he maybe would have gained about a yard. So it was good coverage by Poulos. Big third down play, 3rd and 4 for Schaumburg. Keep this drive alive and they get a first down.
Bill Cantrell checked into the ball game with the play and now he checks back out. 7:40 to go in the third quarter. Howlett is wide to the left, Duden wide to the right. Straight drop, Justin. Intended for Mike Howlett. Justin overthrew him and threw it out of bounds, so on fourth down, I have to get rid of the football.
Oh, yeah, he was just, again, the rush was there. The pressure was on Justin. He just had to throw that ball away. Excellent pressure put on by 4SU.
Fourth down and 4 for the Saxons.
The defensive line of 4SU has played very impressively this afternoon. They're the ones that are applying the pressure on Justin. And Terry, he's had to get rid of the football about a split second sooner than he wants to, and that's what's causing his...
That's what's causing the interruption
stay
in,
so far,
in the flow.
Day. Dan Neenan in to do the punting. Decent kick. It'll take a Schaumburg roll, and it's fielded by Smith at the 30.
That was a pretty chancy play by Smith there at the 30. The ball wouldn't have gone much further beyond him had it rolled maybe a yard further back. And he elected to pick it up, and he just got stampeded by the whole Schaumburg special teams on the punt.
Dave Gehrke and Mike Hollett were in to nail Smith at the 30. So Forest View gets the football in decent field position at their own 30. They do have the wind at their back. They're up 9-0. Jeff Prince into the ball game, lines up as a wide receiver. Draw play, Bizarre, no gain, lost maybe 2 yards on the play. Eric Thorson, number 66, made the initial hit.
Well, Schaumburg wasn't fooled at all on that draw play. Bizarre's been getting a lot of work today and in the backfield for Forest View. Now with 6:49 and ticking left here in the third quarter, there's still a lot of time left in this football game, and I can't see 4SU trying to grind it out now. There's just too much time left. I've got to see Kielbasa put the ball back up in the air.
6:30 to go in the third quarter. 9-0 4SU. Dave Eddy, who caught the touchdown pass, lines up as a slot back, and that's Brad Quast in motion. This is Bizarre on a pitch. Turns the corner right side. He's ridden out of bounds by Steve Bossler out near the 36. That'll stop the clock with 6:20 to go third quarter.
And that brings up a third down, about 4 yards to go, a long 4 yards to go. And this is a big play for Forest View if they want to keep the ball and keep running some time off that clock. A 9-0 lead is not that big against the Schaumburg offense. They can hit you in a hurry. Here you see Bizarre's number. 16 attempts for 82 yards.
All right, Prince is wide to the right. Bizarre slips at the line of scrimmage. It'll go for no gain. And that'll bring up fourth down, and Schaumburg, or I should say Forest View, will have to punt it away.
There you see the partisan Schaumburg crowd here, and they've packed these stands for homecoming. Seeing a good ball game so far, but I'm sure they want to see Schaumburg get on the scoreboard here, make it a little bit more interesting here at the end of the third quarter. Schaumburg's defense is starting to key on Bizarre now. He had a real big first half, and so far here in the second half, he's been limited to 5 yards. rushing.
Dennis Kurtrevik, the center, will snap it to Prince. Low snap. Here's the kick by Prince. It's pretty good with the wind. Taken by Bossler out near the 35. And out to the 37. Before he was tackled by John Kronos, number 62. So the Schaumburg Saxons will start from their own 37. First and 10, they trail 9-0.
That was a tough catch by Bossler, too, because the ball coming at you like a knuckleball like that one was, he caught it on the run. Had a full head of steam and got knocked down, gained up about 5 yards. See if the offense of Schaumburg can start clicking now and put some points on the board.
Schaumburg sends three men wide to the right this time. A pitch out to John Sengstock. Left side has a lot of running room across midfield to the 45. Right down at the 41-yard line into Falcon territory.
That was a very interesting play set up by Tom Sarazani. Put three wide receivers way out on the right side. Pitch out to Sengstock on the left side for a big gain. We're going to see it again. And just a quick pitch, however, everybody was lined up on the left side, and that gave a lot of running room to Sengstock. Almost broke it. Big play, first down for Schaumburg.
They ran to the weak side that time, and it paid off. They have a first down at the Falcon 41. Again, three players line up wide to the right. Sengstock, another big gainer. Pick up about eight, and he'll be close to a first down.
Well, Coach Sarazani found something to work with now here. They're sending three people wide, and Forest View has got to respect Justin and his arm and his passing attack that they have. And so they've got to line up with those three people, and they're creating holes in the middle now of the Forest View defense.
Well, they're setting themselves up. They're lining up with the strong formation of the right side of the field as Howlett, Duden, and number 21, Hanzig, line up wide, and they're running to the weak side. Second and three. Again, Sengstock. First down. Lot of running room to the 20. He might go. Finally brought down by David Eddy. A great tackle, which probably saved a touchdown.
Another first down. Boy, that was just a great play. And whatever Sarazani found, it's easy to explain, but it's got the whole Forest View defense confused. We're looking at it again here now, and they're just running straight up the middle. And that was just a great run by Sengstock, showing a lot of power getting through the initial hole that was opened up by the offensive line.
First and 10 from the 11. Schaumburg, Sengstock, maybe he fumbled the football, let's see.
He got about a yard, maybe two. He held onto the football though.
He did keep it. It looked to me for a minute like it squibbed out of his hands. He may have picked up a yard. Call it second and, oh, they say no gain. Second and 10 now.
There you see John Sengstock on the screen.
Howlett, Panzik, and Duden line up wide to the right. Sengstock again, down to the 7.
Well, again, they're trying the same thing, setting the three receivers way out to the right and trying to run on the left side, the weak side with the pitch. But you can only fool a good football team a few times, and they've got to go to the pass now to one of those receivers if they line up like that again.
Newton, Howlett, and Everett are all wide to the right. Sengstock is the only back. Third down, 5. Justin goes end zone. Intended for Mike Howlett, he threw it too hard.
Yeah, but Howlett was a little bit too much on that play because Howlett was open on a slanting across the middle, and he knew that he had to go to one of those receivers on that play there. They're going to have to go for the field goal now, get down by a touchdown. But Howlett was open. Justin just threw the ball too hard and let him too much.
So on fourth down, the Saxons will attempt a field goal. Kurt Farman is in to do the kicking. This will be a 25-yard attempt. Snap is perfect. Here's Farman's kick. It is Good. So with 2:14 left to go in the third quarter, it is now Forest View 9 and Schaumburg 3.
Okay, I'd like to mention that this game is being brought to you by Flaherty Jewelers, your personal jeweler for fine diamond jewelry and jewelry repairs at 2 South Dunton in downtown Arlington Heights. Follow Mount Prospect State Bank for all your financial needs at the corner of Bussey and Emerson in downtown Mount Prospect. And also by Ray Oldsmobile, 501 Bussey Highway in Park Ridge. At Ray Oldsmobile, our bottom line price is always less.
There you see the score and the time left in the third quarter, and we have a football game on our hand here at Schaumburg High School. And the man that kicked the field goal, Kurt Farman, will tee it up for Schaumburg.
Well, that missed extra point by Forest View on their last touchdown is going to play an important role here now in the last 2 minutes and 14 seconds of the third quarter and the final 12 minutes of the fourth quarter.
Bazaar and Smith are deep for Forest View. This kick will go into the wind. Not a long kick, but it will be taken by Smith at the 15. Has some running room across the 20. 30. Finally tackled at the 30-yard line by Steve Bosler. A good return.
Definitely a good return because he had slipped. That was a tough ball to handle. It came at him bouncing in all different directions, and he picked it up, eluded the first tackler, and ran around to the left side. Picked up a good 15, 20 yards and get him out over the 30. Good field position.
And Terry, I think Tom Sarasani found a weakness in the Forest View defense. They were lining up with a very strong formation to the right side, and they kept running to the weak side, and that enabled them to get their 3 points that time. First and 10 from the 31 for Forest View. On first down, Kielbasa wants to throw. Pumps once, goes deep. Intended for Jeff Prince, ball's incomplete.
There's a flag on the play, too, and it's in the general area of illegal procedure. Illegal motion, one of the two. That's an illegal motion by Forest View.
That's what it is. Well, Terry, Fred Lusso knows that he cannot milk the clock and sit on the football. He knows that his team has to sustain a drive, and I think on first down they did the right thing. They tried to get something going and pick up a big gainer. Worked for him before, but they came up empty-handed that time.
And that could open up some running room for Bazaar.
Here's a pitch to Bazaar. He tries the left side. Gains some yardage out near the 34-yard line.
Picked up close to 4 yards on that play. It's going to be a big third down, third and a long six. Oh, I'm sorry, a second down with the penalty. Picked up about 7 yards on that play.
Second and 8. Dave Eddy is wide to the right side of the field for Forest View. And Jeff Prince split to the left side. Draw play, Dan Bazaar, no gain. Eric Thorson was at the line of scrimmage and made the initial hit. That'll bring up third down.
Big play by Thorson. Lost 3 on that play. It makes it. Takes it back to the original line of scrimmage now. There you see the replay, and Thorson was not fooled at all, and he shows his emotion there after he made the stop.
That's about, Terry, I think the third time they've tried that today, and because it's so tough to get your footing in the middle part of the field, they've been ineffective. A big third and 10 play for Forest View. The Kielbasa has nobody open. Now he sends it over the middle. In and out of the hands of David Eddy. A good toss.
Great toss. Had a lot of time. Schaumburg just went way back into his zone coverage, and Eddy almost came up with a great catch. Ball was tipped, and he could have caught it had he known where the ball was tipped. It was tipped right next to him.
Good defensive coverage by Mike Hollitz on fourth down. With 11 seconds to go here in the third quarter, Schaumburg will probably get the football back as Prince is in the punt.
Well, you can tell by that picture right there on your screen. who's been in the football game for the whole game and who's coming in to punt.
Steve Bosler and Mike Howlett are deep for Schaumburg. This is a terrific kick by Prince all the way back to the 34-yard line. Fair catch called for by Bosler. Saxons will take over first.
Right now is on Forest View, really, because of how easily Schaumburg moved the football down the field last time. See if they set up with the same kind of formation they had last time, and they do.
Hanzik in the slot in motion. A mix-up on the handoff. That's the play that they fumbled on earlier in the game, which caused a turnover. At any rate, that is the end of the third quarter of play here at Schaumburg High School with the score. The Forest View Falcons 9, the Schaumburg Saxons 3. They're watching Kurt Groner and Terry Lockman along with the rest of our cable net crew here at Schaumburg High School. On first down while we were away, Mike Howlett was the intended receiver for a down and out pattern that was incomplete at about the 50-yard line. So it'll be third down and 12 for the Schaumburg Saxons from their own 31-yard line. Howlett again is wide to the left side. That's Panzik in motion, and Justin on a straight drop will throw. He has a man open at the 40, about the 44-yard line.
Looks like Mike
Howlett.
Mike Howlett again. And you made a good point here at the end of the third quarter, Bert, when we said that Schaumburg now has the wind at their back. Here's the replay where Howlett was wide open over the middle. And we'll get to see it here right in your screen as Justin goes back. Shows a little bit of pressure coming up on him, and there's Howlett wide open.
Scott
but they've
Miller.
They've got the wind at their back now, and that'll be in the favor of Paul Justin and his passing attack.
11:30 in the fourth quarter. 9-3 Forest View. First and 10 Schaumburg. This is Sengstock.
Well, Sengstock carried about three Forest View people right on his back for that 5-yard gain. There's head coach Fred Lessau of Forest View. Did a great job with his Forest View Falcons this year. They're undefeated so far going into this ball game, but there's still 11 minutes left in the fourth quarter. Schaumburg's got the ball, they're moving, and they're down by 6 points.
Jeff Duden, number 31, checks into the game for Schaumburg. And Mike Everett lines up wide. This is what they've been trying so far. Second and 5. Justin setting up a screen. Has Sengstock across midfield to the 40. Keeps going. Bumped out of bounds at the 25-yard line by number 17, Steve Polis.
Well, that screen was set up perfectly. The blitz was on by Forest View, and Justin almost fell down as he was going back in the pocket and then let the ball go just at the right time. Here you see it again. He almost slipped there going back. The pressure was on, set up the screen perfectly. That's Sengstock, who shows some good running ability, getting down out to the sidelines. Big gain for Schaumburg.
And this time, Terry, they lined up with a strong formation to their right side, and they completed a pass that way. That time it was a screen play. Bill Cantrell checks into the ball game for Schaumburg. He goes wide to the left side. First and 10 from the Falcon 45 for Schaumburg. Looked like Sengstock. He was hit at the line of scrimmage.
Great defensive play by number 66, Brian McCarthy, and we've called his number before. He's made plays like that before this year, and that was just a great stop. He read that play. There you see Paul Justin's number. He's 6 out of 16 for 108 yards with those two interceptions.
Mike Howlett back into the game for Schaumburg. 10 minutes to go, fourth quarter. 9-3, Forest View. Panzik and Duden are wide to the right. Straight drop, blitz. He gets the ball off, complete to Sengstock. Out of bounds at the 6-yard line. Brad Frost wrote him out of bounds.
Again, that was a great play. The screen was set up for you again, coming in on the blitz, and Justin must have read that because Sengstock was the exact same play that there was a gainer from the previous time. And there you see it again, set up perfectly. Perfect throw by Justin to Sengstock, and he threw that ball over number 65, Justin Beach. at first and goal for Schaumburg at the 7-yard line.
It is first and goal, as Terry mentioned. 9:45 to go, fourth quarter. This is Nick Panzik. Runs into a wall, including Thomas Wilson, number 75, may have gotten a yard on the play.
Tough to run against this Forest View team, as they have proved that all along today. I wouldn't be surprised to see that play that we saw on the other side over here with Howlett slanting over the middle. As Howlett checks in the ball game, maybe he's bringing in a play for his number. Nope, because he's checking back out.
Greg Abaduto lines up as a tight end this time to the left side of the formation. Second and five, in motion, Jeff Duden. Sangstock. Wrestled by Brad Quast. He'll be lucky if he got to the original line of scrimmage.
Nice stop by Brad Quast. They're having trouble running, you know. Both teams really are having trouble down when they get in close, as we saw when Forest View was down here earlier in the second half. Their first two running plays, they were stopped, and then they had to throw the ball into the end zone for a touchdown. We're in the same situation here now for Schaumburg.
This time Duden lines up wide to the right. Again, the tight end is Abaduto into the ball game. Straight drop, Justin, end zone. Touchdown, Duden.
Boy, that was a great pass by Paul Justin. Hit Duden right in the corner of the end zone. His foot was almost out of bounds, and it was a great catch for the touchdown. We're all tied up. This is a very big extra point, and that shows how important the extra point that Forest View missed.
It is now a tie ball game. Kurt Farman is in for Schaumburg to attempt the extra point. Mike Howlett will hold. You see the replay. Well, this is a run by Sengstock earlier. Here's the extra point try. Perfect snap. Blocked. The kick was blocked.
Great special teams by Forest View to block that punt. 9-9 tie.
I believe Justin Beach, number 65, got in there to block the extra point attempt.
Well, he came out of nowhere on that one. Tie ball game. Now, what Schaumburg has to do is they have to get the football back, score a touchdown, go for the two-point conversion, and complete that in order to take this MSL South crown. So they've got to get the ball back. Justin is 8 out of 18 for 125 yards, two interceptions, and one touchdown.
So there's 8:21 left to go in the fourth quarter, and we're all tied up at 9.
And while we've got a break here, I'd like to mention once again this game is being brought to you in part by Flaherty Jewelers, your personal jeweler for fine diamond jewelry and jewelry repairs at 2 South Dutton in downtown Arlington Heights. By the Mount Prospect State Bank for all your financial needs at the corner of Bussey and Emerson in downtown Mount Prospect. And also by Ray Oldsmobile, 501 Bussey Highway in Park Ridge. Yes, you can save money on your next new car purchase at Ray Oldsmobile.
Here's Kurt Farman's kickoff for Schaumburg. It's a low kick. It's taken by Smith at the 15, at the 20. Little running room out to the 30. Finally goes out of bounds. We'll have to see where they spot the football. They say at about the 37-yard line.
Again, that was a good return by Smith. Did the same thing on the last kickoff. Ball kind of died on him. He picked it up and made a big gain out of something that could have been trouble for Forest View.
Terry, that was getting back to that block. A great play by number 65, Justin Beach, who got in there, came out of nowhere, and the snap was perfect. The formation was perfect. He just came out of nowhere and blocked that kick. 9-9, Ron Kielbasa. Let's see what he and his Forest View Falcons can do. A pitch to Bizarre. Across the 40, out near the 45, before being ridden out of bounds by Steve Bosler.
Well, you know, that's all Forest View wants to do now is try to grind this out. There's still a lot of time left in the ball game, 8-11. And I'm sure Coach Lessau did not want to see Bizarre go out of bounds on that play there to stop the clock.
And at this stage of the football game, the key is maintaining control of the football. 8:10 to go in the fourth quarter. Second and five on the run by Bizarre. Again, he gets the carry. Hit at the original line of scrimmage, a crunching hit made by Dave Gerke, number 64.
Well, this Schaumburg defense is fired up. They know what they have to do. They have to get the ball back. They've got to stop them here now. They can't let them, they can't let Forest View get another first down and take control of the ball and the clock. They know what they've got to do. They've got to stop them, get the ball back, score a touchdown, complete the two-point conversion, and they'll win the MSL South. Sounds so easy, doesn't it?
Well, it's easier said than done, that's for sure. On third and four, Jeff Prince checks into the ball game. Kilbasa going deep for Prince. Pickoff.
Number 12, Mike Hollow was there with the pickoff. It was almost an outstanding catch by Jeff Prince, and then he actually deflected the ball, and Hollett maintained control of it. Just a great interception by Hollett, because Prince did have a chance to catch that football.
The throw may have been a little overled to Jeff Prince, and that was a great interception by Hollett.
We're going to see it again. Now, maybe if you can see Hollett. Well, that was tough to follow that replay.
On the interception, Schaumburg, first and 10 from their own 31-yard line. It's a Singstock, a gain of maybe four.
Still a lot of time left in the ball game. 6:55. Schaumburg's got the wind at their back. They've got the arm and the passing attack, the arm of Paul Justin, the passing attack of Tom Sarazani. It's going
to
be
they still managed to confuse the Forest View defense with the formation of the strong side of the field. Jeff Duden, wide to the right. Panzig lines up to the left side this time. Complete to Duden. Out to the 47.
What a catch by Duden. He caught the ball right at the numbers and he dropped it. And he showed the concentration to maintain control as he dropped it and he picked it up just before it was going to hit the ground. And he got a first down out of the play. The clock is still moving now. 6:18 left in the ball game. 9-9 tie. Momentum is definitely on Schaumburg's side right now.
No question about it. Hanzig lines up wide to the left in a slot. Jeff Duden wide to the right. The handoff goes to Singstock. Big opener. All the way down to the 31-yard line before he was brought down by number 20, John Cole.
Boy, Schaumburg has just shown a really great balanced attack here on this offensive series. They're passing the ball, they're running the ball. That was just an excellent run by Sangstock. And Tom Sarazani definitely found something in that Forest View defense. When he lines up those three receivers on the strong side, on the right side, he makes things happen.
They spotted at the 33. It's a first and 10 for Schaumburg in Falcon territory. Singstock again. Maybe three or four. Brad Quast finally got to him.
Got 5:30 left in the football game. And Schaumburg, if they keep on moving the way they do, they're actually doing what they need to do. They can get the ball down to within striking distance of the goal line and run time off the clock, they won't give Forest View a chance to get the ball back.
Dan Somm, number 87, is into the ballgame for Schaumburg as a tight end, and the Saxons call a timeout, and they want to talk this over.
It's really not a bad timeout, because there is 5 minutes, 5 seconds left here in the fourth quarter. They are down on the 30-yard line. Second down, 8 yards to go. Talk it over, settle the kids down. Coach Sarazani will tell them exactly what he wants to do. There you see some of the Schaumburg fans here having a good time, hoping their Saxons can get into the end zone. And that tells the story right there. Ball on the 30-yard line. Second down, 8 yards to go. We're in the fourth quarter, 5:05 to go. Sarazani's done talking to his troops, so I think that might have been just a timeout to settle his kids down a little bit.
Right, I think this will especially benefit Forest View's defense. And Terry, you know, football, especially for the coaching staff, is a game of adjustments. Schaumburg's offensive coaching staff has been able to adjust, and they've been able to move the football. Now it's Forest View. It's the responsibility of them defensively to adjust, because Schaumburg is moving the football.
We'll see how Coach Lessau adjusts to what Schaumburg's been doing to him.
Second and eight, here's a pass. Picked off. Scott Miller with his second interception of the game on an errant pass by Paul Justin. A big turnover, and Forest View gets the football back.
Well, now what the Schaumburg defense has to do, that was a definite big turnover. I think Justin might have gotten hit, and the ball was just up for grabs, anybody's football. But what Schaumburg has to do now is they have to stop Forest View, go into hopefully an overtime, and they can still win in the overtime.
4:40 to go in the fourth quarter. Forest View with the football. We're tied at nine here at Schaumburg High School. A pitch to Bizarre. And he was nailed probably for a loss. Dennis Stoika, number 51, got to him.
Now this will be interesting. If you think about the possibilities of what would happen in overtime, Bert, what Schaumburg would want to do is they have to win by 8 points in order to win this. So if they score a touchdown, in overtime they go for the extra point. If they score a touchdown, they get four plays.
Right, well, they probably have to go for two.
Well, we're going to talk about this in just a minute with the score 9-9, 4:29 left to go in the game.
Down and 10 for Forest View. Kilbasa, straight drop. Left side has a man open, and it's dropped in and out of the hands of Steve Polis.
Now that was just it was a perfect strike by Kilbasa, and Poulos just, I think he might have tried to run with the football before he had control of it. The point that I was trying to make before, though, about this, if it goes into overtime, you got to think about it, just the possibilities. If it goes into overtime, Schaumburg would want to get the football first, only because if they score a touchdown, they'll go for the two-point conversion and go up by 8 points, and then let their defense try to hold Forest View to nothing. However, if Forest View gets the ball first and doesn't score and Schaumburg scores,
we got penalty flags all over the field. Okay, continue what you were saying, Terry.
If Schaumburg scores, then they will just win by 6 points. You understand what I'm saying? They won't have to kick the field goal or go for the extra point because they won.
Well, first they'd have to get possession if it indeed went into overtime, as we have a penalty here. It looks like it's against Forest View that'll cost them five. And Schaumburg must win by more than 7 points if they want to have a shot at the Mid-Suburban League title.
So that's what I was saying. We'll get back in after this play. There's still 4:08 left to go in the fourth quarter.
All right, it's third and 15 for Forest View. Bizarre on the carry. Breaks a tackle. Gets close to the 20-yard line. Mike Everett tackled him there. They'll be short of a first down. They'll have to kick the football away.
They should wind up. Schaumburg should wind up with excellent field position here because Forest View's got a kick into the wind.
And Terry, for Schaumburg, a field goal, even if they win the football game, will do them no good. So if they've
got to go for the 6 points.
Right, we could see them in position to win the football game, and I'm sure there might be a lot of people here, not only in the stands but watching them, might wonder why they would not attempt to do that. There's a kick by Prince that goes off the side of his foot, but it takes a Falcon bounce. Is down at the 49-yard line.
All right, this is the ball game right here. 3:22 left in the ball game. Excellent field position for Schaumburg. They got the wind at their back. They bring the ball down. They've got to go for the 6 points. And then it'll be a decision. You know, we haven't thought about that possibility, but it'll be a decision by Tom Sarazani. Does he want to go for the 2 points and win the division outright? Or does he want to go for a tie? Because if he loses and doesn't win on the gamble of the 2 points, they may not get up an at-large playoff berth.
Well, those are a lot of ifs. All right, from midfield, Schaumburg, first and 10, 3:05 to go. Shotgun formation, Justin. Quick snap to Sengstock. And he's nailed for a loss of about 3 yards on the play.
Coach Sarazani is pulling everything out of his bag of tricks that he's got on the sidelines there. And Forest View, again, did not get fooled by that play.
Second and 12 from the 48. Remember, in order to win the MSL, Schaumburg needs to win this game by more than 7 points, and we're tied at 9 right now. Justin on a straight drop over the middle. almost intercepted by Polis. Went in and out of his hands.
Now this brings up a big third down play here. Now that was a nice defensive play by Polis. And they're showing some great coverage downfield. Forest View is on Schaumburg. It brings up a big third down play now for Schaumburg. They've got to complete this. Third and 12.
2:22 in the fourth quarter.
You know Forest View is going to come out in the zone defense.
And they, again, line up with three receivers on the right side of the field. And now Panza going in motion. Justin will throw. He's going deep. He apparently thought Mike Everett was going to continue his route down the field, and Everett came back for the football. That'll go incomplete.
Now it looks like we're heading for overtime.
.216 to go fourth quarter. It is fourth and 12 for Schaumburg. And Dan Neenan is in to punt the football away.
You know, this is where all the pressure comes on here now. And both of these teams. It's a big punt here by Neenan to get them deep in their own territory to force a possible overtime.
Jack Smith is the deep man. His kick will come from about the Saxon 40. Good snap. Terrific kick. Taken at the 16 by Smith across to the 20. To the 25. He's finally ridden out of bounds by Mike Everett. A good return by Jack Smith. And with 2:05 to go, this appears to be the last drive in regulation time for the Forest View Falcons.
Well, we haven't seen too many tricks out of Coach Lessau's bag of tricks, so to speak, on the other side of the sidelines. And with 2 minutes and 5 seconds left, we may see something in order to try to break this open and not have to face an overtime situation.
From the 29, Ron Kilbasa and his Forest View Falcons. First and 10, handoff. Dan Bazaar to the 31. Dennis Stoika was in on the tackle for Schaumburg, a pickup of about 2.5 yards.
Now we've got a minute 48 to go. I don't think, from the looks of that first play, that Coach Lessau wants to do anything that would cause any kind of a turnover. So he just may run this out and go into the overtime and face those consequences.
Right, sir. He's in a position to be a little bit more conservative because of his team's record. He doesn't really have to gamble because of the situation he's in. Again, Dan Bazaar, lucky to get back to the line of scrimmage.
However, I get back to that point where if they go into overtime, Schaumburg gets first possession, and they go and they score a touchdown and they complete the two-point conversion. That'll put them up by eight. Granted, Forest View will have a chance to come back, but if their defense can hold them and they win by eight, Forest View loses the MSL South title.
.55 in the fourth quarter. Jeff Prince goes in motion. Another pitch to Bazaar. Turns it the right side. And he was gang tackled. Steve Bosler in on the play for Schaumburg.
But he got enough for the first down.
He did. .40 left for the quarter.
There you see the replay again as Bazaar showed some good running ability and good second effort to get across the first yard marker for the first down and keep possession in Forest View's hands.
.20 for the quarter. I formation this time from the 40, first and 10. Again, Dan Bazaar lunges to the 46.
Now that may be the last play here of the fourth quarter and of regulation as we go into overtime. That's it, 3 seconds left.
Don't fall out of your chair, Terry. All right, at the end of regulation time here at Schaumburg High School, the score, the Schaumburg Saxons 9, the Forest View Falcons 9. We'll keep it right here.
Well, now we can go over all those possibilities again as to what can happen here in overtime. As we talked about, if Schaumburg They have a flip like they do at the beginning of the football game. We're starting over again, and if Schaumburg wins the tip and it gets possession of the ball first, the coin toss, excuse me, not the tip. If they win the coin toss and get possession of the football first, score a touchdown, convert the two-point conversion, then they're up by 8 points, and it's up to the defense to hold Forest View down, and if they win by 8 points, they win the MSL South. However, if Forest View wins the coin toss and they get the football first, and they don't score, and Schaumburg comes back and scores, and they just win on it by a touchdown by 6 points because they don't need the two-point conversion.
All right, in overtime.
4 minutes on the clock.
High school football, the way it works, each team will get four possessions of the football from the 10-yard line, and they will go. They will go back and forth until one team outscores the other. And an interesting situation here, Terry, facing both coaches. Fred Lusso and his team, they can also win the MSL title if they lose by less than 7 points.
You know, we've got both coaches out there talking with the referee, and maybe they're going over that point that I talked about, that if Forest U gets the ball first and they don't score, and Schaumburg gets the ball and they come in and score a touchdown, will the officials allow Schaumburg the two-point conversion? Because it does mean something for the Schaumburg High School team, and maybe that's what they're determining right now in overtime.
Right, I'm sure that's what they're talking about. Saw a moment ago Tom Sarasani walking off the field, and now Fred Lusso and his team discussing the possibilities with his squad. It appears that Forest View will have the first four shots at scoring.
Well, the officials are now talking about what can happen here. It could be interesting, because there's been no indication up here in the press box as to what could happen so there are so many things that can happen here, Ed, with 52 seconds left here in between the regulation and overtime period. That's something I didn't even think about. They could just go in there, kick a field goal, and let Schaumburg score and walk home with the MSL South crown, and not even feel bad about it.
Right, of course, the key is who gets possession first. Obviously, the team that does get it will have a tremendous advantage.
There you see Tom Sarazani, the coach of Schaumburg, who just had to think about all those different things that we were just talking about. We're still arguing about that interception back in the first half with everybody in the press box here.
All right, well, right now both captains of both teams are out at midfield, and I guess they're going to flip the coin right now. I thought a moment ago they had flipped it earlier. But they're going to flip a coin right now to see who gets possession of the football. Again, they'll start from the opposing team's 10-yard line. They'll each get four plays, and whoever has the most points at the end of their series of downs is the winner of the football game.
You know, and it keeps on going until there's a winner, an outright winner. And it would be to, and I don't think we'll see that happen here, because if Schaumburg does get the ball first and they score a touchdown, and because if Schaumburg does win it, they're almost a lock of getting into the playoffs over Conant on the point system with the schedule of playing Forest View and beating them. I'm glad I don't have to figure out those at-large berths.
They are still discussing. It appears that Forest View did win the coin toss. They are discussing which end of the field that they will... I know Schaumburg did get the ball. They're discussing which end of the field that... the area of play will take place. You got to look at Dan Bazaar.
Well, I tell you, the announcer here in the press box is going nuts, trying to get this crowd cheered up.
Paul Justin and his offensive unit trot out onto the field. It is first and goal from the 10. That is essentially the way it works here. And it is, if Schaumburg indeed scores first, it does not mean the football game is automatically over. It'll depend on what Forest View does too. First and 10 in overtime. No time on the clock. Singstock to about the 6. He's been the workhorse all year for this team. Coming into this afternoon's action, he had gained over 450 yards. He's averaging about 4 yards a pop, so you can expect them to keep it on the ground and hand it off to John Singstock.
Well, they're lining up in that strong formation again with three receivers on the left side.
Singstock again up the middle, maybe about 3.
Well, this is a big third down here. You know, they got two more cracks at it, and they've got to get a touchdown. A field goal will do them no good.
Third down, and they say 5. So 5 yards to go for a score for Schaumburg here in overtime. This time, 3 receivers are wide to the right side of the field. Everett Duden and Panzik. And now Tom Sarasani wants a timeout. That's the largest cracker I've ever seen, Terry.
The largest what?
Cracker. Terry Lockman destroying some of the furniture that they provide us here in the press box. 9-9 the score. The time factor is not important, as Schaumburg will have 2 more downs left. 3rd and 5. Tom Sarasani, I think, discussing what plays they do want to run, and he's probably asking his offensive line if they feel that they can surge enough for John Singstock to carry the ball in 2 more times.
Well, I looked for the slanting pattern for Howell to run the last time Schaumburg was down in this part of the playing field down inside the 10-yard line, and Howlett's lining up on the left side along with Duden and Everett, so we may see that quick slanting pass route by him again.
3rd and 5. Straight drop. Justin, end zone, has a man open. Touchdown. Mike
Howlett. That's what Schaumburg needed. Excellent play. Instead of slanting, Howlett went down and out into the corner of the end zone. It was a perfect pass and a big, big clutch reception by Mike Howlett.
Great call.
They've got to get this 2-point conversion now. And if they get that, I don't know. You know, Sangstock, they've got to get 3 yards now. Here's the replay of the touchdown. It was just a beautiful catch by Holla. Perfect pass by Justin. And that's what Schaumburg need to do. They got to get this 2-point conversion out from the 3-yard line.
It's now 15-9 Schaumburg. See what they do. They want to throw Justin end zone. Duden, they got it.
Right now, Schaumburg is in the lead in the MSL South. What a comeback by Schaumburg. They had to do that. Tom Sarazani took the right time to call timeout. Made a beautiful play to Hollow for the touchdown.
Unbelievable call. What a great catch by Duden, too.
Great catch by
covered.
Duden. Hollow for the touchdown. Duden for the 2-point conversion. We're going to see it again. Watch the poise there by Justin and the concentration by Duden. An excellent catch. Put Schaumburg up by 8 points. And if their defense can hold Forest View here to not scoring a point, Schaumburg is the new MSL South division leader. and we'll take the division.
What a great call. The coverage by Dave Eddy was terrific. You couldn't ask for better coverage, Terry, by a defensive back. It's just the pass and the execution by Duden was terrific. So the score now, 17-9 in favor of Schaumburg.
And the pass was just perfect by Justin.
Now you do have to remember, too, Terry, Forest View can kick a field goal.
It'll be interesting to see what they do, if they try to get the ball in closer or Bow wants to do here now, because he can't risk any kind of a fumble or an interception, and he's not going to go for the field goal right now. They're going to go for a touchdown.
On first down from the 10, Dan Bazaar back to the original line of scrimmage, gang tackle.
It's going to be tough to run against the Schaumburg team now, and you can just tell how Forest View is feeling. They're down right now, but they got to remember they're not out of this football game. All they need is a field goal. They've got the wind at their back. If they may be trying to get closer, and that might not be such a good idea either.
As we Forest got a timeout calls, by Forest View.
Forest View calls timeout, and Coach Lessau is going to come out. They may be trying to get closer, but what that might do is that allows the line, the defensive line of Schaumburg, to get a better angle on the football.
Line of the Schaumburg Saxons has really hung tough when they had to. Dan Bazaar, who had an excellent first half, has been really shut down in the second half, and now in overtime, you sort of expect that he's going to get the football, and the defensive line's done a terrific job.
Well, again, you know, the bread and butter for Forest View pretty much this whole year has been on that option rollout by Kilbasa, and we haven't seen much of that in this football game. They started out with doing it, and it was successful. So maybe we'll see that again here.
Second and 9 for Forest View. The crowd making a lot of noise here at Schaumburg High School. Kilbasa will throw. Heavy pressure. He'll keep it. A little bit of running room. Great tackle by Matt Sempsey, number 30.
Well, Kilbasa had room on the outside. He just had trouble getting his footing down. And number 30, Matt Sempsey, just made a great, great stop. It was up to Sempsey to stop him, because Kilbasa, had he gotten around Sempsey, would have gone into the end zone. That would have been the ball game.
Another timeout is taken by Forest View, and Terry, it appeared that Kilbasa, he obviously wanted to go end zone, but Sepsi just had the angle on him and ran him down.
That's what happened. Had he gotten around Sepsi, though, showed the good speed getting over to Kilbasa, I mean, he would have been in the corner of the end zone. Just taking a look at Tom Sarazani. He's got his defensive coordinator out there talking to his defensive troops, and Coach Sarazani is just way over.
Outstanding high school football game. 17-9, Schaumburg in a terrific comeback. Bazaar, he stopped short, so this will bring up fourth down.
To bring up a field goal attempt.
And Jeff Prince, number 11, is on to attempt a field goal. And I think a lot of the fans might be confused as to why they would attempt a field goal. Forest View can win the MSL South if they lose by less than 7 points. So they're losing by 8 right now. If Prince is
right now to for this field goal, he does have the wind at his back. He's on the right side of the field. It's on the right hash mark.
And don't be surprised if you see Schaumburg use up their remaining timeouts to make Mr. Prince think about this kick.
Oh, there's no doubt about that. So it all goes down to the final play in overtime to determine the Mid-Suburban League South Division champion. And this has just been a great football game, one of the best that we've ever had here on cable night. Glad you're with us. And you're right, there's Schaumburg calling timeout, and they're going to try to put a little bit more ice in the veins of Jeff Prince.
Well, Terry, we've seen so far today, I mean, based on the field conditions, which are
problems with the snap there. With seeing the way Prince is kicking the pass, he can do it. Well, this will be the MSL South play right here.
Kilbasa will hold. Penalty flag. This might be a delay call against Forest View. We'll see.
I didn't see what the official signal was. Now it's a 5-yard mark. Oh, they're sending them up to 5-yard mark off against Forest View. It might have been a player who lined up offsides against.
That's exactly what it was, encroachment. And this really changes the outcome of the game. They'll spot it now at the 20. That's where Prince wants to have the ball spotted. So this will be a 30-yard field goal, Terry. The wind also isn't directly at his back. It's more or less blowing from the northwest to the southeast. So he'll have to judge that, too, in his kick.
Well, we got all the Schaumburg players who are on the sidelines trying to rev this crowd up, put some more pressure on Prince. And we'll try it again. This is it.
This will be from 30 yards. The snap is all right. Here's the kick. It is
good. And Forest View maintains the MSL South crown. Schaumburg wins the football game 17-12. However, Forest View wins the MSL South by the point factor of this ball game by 5 points. Congratulations to Forest View and to Schaumburg. They both played a terrific game. Congratulations to Forest View for the MSL South, and good luck in the playoffs.
What a great kick by Jeff Prince under a lot of pressure. They did everything they could to try and win the MSL title. They did win the football game, but that's academic, really, when it comes
in the overtime with the... It was third down. They got the touchdown on a beautiful play by, or a beautiful pass by Justin to Howlett. And then that two-point conversion, the pressure that was on Duden and the pressure that was on Justin, just to make that, and then the way they executed it was perfect. There's the final, 17-12 in a beautifully fought football game. We're coming right back.
I mean, what more can you ask? They won the football game. They beat Forest View. Just the circumstances dictated the fact that with the point system, Forest View wins the MSL South. So, you know, just a strange set of circumstances. You can't ask Schaumburg to do anything more.
No, you know, they came out here and they did what they had to do. They almost, you know, put Forest View in second place in MSL South by taking the crown in overtime. However, they did win the football game, and they needed that for their playoff chances. Now, Conant, that pretty much puts them on the outs because they did beat Schaumburg. However, they lost to Forest View, and now Schaumburg beat Forest View, and the way their record is, if they win their last game next week, they'll be in the playoffs. There's no doubt about it.
All right, the final score here.